Bring our burdens and we lay them down, and He forgives, and we can move forward knowing His grace and His love will always follow us. Let's be reminded of that as we read together today. God, our delight, our commitment is to You, O God. Our concern is your kingdom. Carve away the misery that plagues our hearts. We confess the impact our temporary circumstances have on us. Keep anxiety and fear far from us. Forgive us for getting lost in the distractions of a moment. May we commit ourselves to you, still our souls, and calm our minds. Amen. You can take a seat. God is always faithful to bring healing and forgiveness to us when we confess. In a moment of silent confession, I invite you to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you the ways that you've personally sinned and you've broken your relationship with Him. Communion servers, you can go ahead, you can take your place. Grace 5-6 students, you can meet your leaders in the lobby after you take communion. But let's take a moment and let's silently.
Amen. This morning, it is our happy and holy privilege to come together as Christ Church to participate and celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. Each time we gather, we come to do some things that the church has done for the last 2,000 years. That's because repetition is the mother of all learning. First, we come for worship. We worship because God created us to worship. There is nothing more fully human than to connect with God in and through worship, because God made us to worship. He created us as worshiping beings. But we don't worship all the time. In fact, sometimes we make the decision to walk a different path. And that's what confession is for. God leaves confession behind for us because He wants us to remember that even when we fall down, even when we fail, what we are some of the time is not what He wants us to be all the time. So He gives us confession. This gift is amazing because what He's basically saying to us is, when you turn away from your wickedness and turn away from your misalignment with His will, what happens is God meets you in those spaces and places. And instead of coming with condemnation, here's what He does. He comes reminding us of who we are. Remember who you are. Remember that you belong to me. Remember that I am yours and you are mine. And in the middle of all of that, we return and our hearts are back in alignment with Him. And then we come for communion. Even the word communion, it means union with God. And so this communion is a reminder to us that we don't just believe good things about God, but we have God that dwells within us. He comes with us, walks with us, lives with us every day of our life for those who follow Jesus. In a few minutes, you're gonna hear me teach from the Bible. And the reason why we focus so much on the Bible is because that information that we have right there blesses our life, both in the next life and in this life. It gives us clarity, it gives us direction, and it gives us wisdom. And when we have those things, it's easier to navigate a world that is often switching and changing very fast and filled with complicated moral decisions. And so when we step into that, we are changed and transformed. On the night when Jesus was betrayed 2,000 years ago, He gathered together His 12 closest friends. He took bread, He blessed it, and He gave it to each of them. And He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat this in remembrance of me." After supper, He gave them the cup, and He said, "This is my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink this until the day that I return." And we recognize that one day Jesus will return. And when He returns, He comes to heal all of us who have trusted Him in this life. And His greatest desire, no matter what you hear today in a message, no matter what you listen to in worship or experience here in community, our deepest desire for you is to know Jesus in this life so that your life can be changed here and then also for eternity. Because God loves you, He sent Jesus into the world to die for your sins. Not because He wanted anything from you, but He wanted everything for you. And our deep desire is that you will have that same experience. Listen, if this is your first time at Grace, welcome. We're glad you're here. We use the intinction method for communion, which means you'll take a piece of the wafer, dip it into the cup, and you can participate in communion here. On each side of the stage are tables of cards on them. Feel free to come forward during communion. Write down any prayer requests you have. We would love to pray for whatever needs you have. Someone's going to come grab those. And while I'm teaching, you will be being prayed for. So as soon as the communion servers are in place in the back of the room and in the front, you can come. 920. Great to see you guys. Hey, real quick, an announcement off the top of my head. We have a 1230 service. Have you heard of it? It's awesome. We got the metal chairs out. People are sitting on the floor. So you, at this point, we need to move some people from this service to the 1230. It was the most successful launch we've ever had of a service. It's our sixth service. God is showing up there. The Holy Spirit said, if you go, you're guaranteed to go to heaven. Okay, so just show up. It's gonna be great, okay? Father, we are so thankful for your love for us. Thankful that you really do care about the intimate details of our life. Today, as we talk through the intersection in Psalm 37 of anxiety and control, we ask God that you would just give us peace, give us vision, give us direction. We know it's not your desire for us to walk overwhelmed all the time. So we ask God that you just be in us and for us. It's in your name we pray, amen. So we're gonna jump into this right now, Psalm 37. We're gonna be looking at verses 6 through 10 today. I wanna read them and you guys can follow along on the screen. Psalm 37, 6, he will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. I will be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret, it only leads to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. A little while and the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. So last week I introduced the idea, our big idea for the series, which is misery is in the heart, not the circumstances. Misery is in the heart, not the circumstances. And the beautiful thing about that is this, it basically teaches us that really at the end of the day, misery, the kind of stuff that we carry around, anxiousness, fear, worry, whatever it is, we carry that with us all the time. It's not based on our circumstances. Like if you just had a little bit better circumstances, you'd feel better. The reality is, it doesn't matter. You can take two people who look at the same circumstance and come out with radically different interpretations of the situation. One has a different lens than the other. And the one who has the negative lens will end up being feeling negative their whole life, right? If they don't change their lens. So misery is in the heart. Here's the thing, just a really positive thing up front. You are not the victim of your anxiety. You do not have to be anxious all the days of your life. But I do wanna manage expectations. I wanna tell you guys that this is not an attempt to try to rid us of all anxiety. Not all anxiety is bad. Some anxiety is super instructive. In fact, some anxiety is actually helpful so that we don't end up hurting ourselves. It shows us, it reveals the dangers. So one day I was in the Wakaiva forest and I was just walking around. I was all by myself, just kind of chilling and walking through the woods, and every once in a while I just try to do that. And so I'm walking there and then I heard this like, you know, this sound, right? And I looked over because I was totally looking the other way, and about 6 feet away from me, there was this bear, right? And he's right there. And so my mind instantly went to, you know, I bet if I kick him in the face and run, I can get away. Which apparently you're not supposed to do. So we just looked at each other for a second. He was looking right at me, I was looking right at him. And so I rushed him really quick and I hit, no, I did not. That's not what I did. But wouldn't that have been a cool story? I wish I could go back in time and just do it. But the story you would have been listening to is Mike died in the Wakaiva forest, right? Not a wise thing to do, right? And so like our place where we are right now is to recognize that some anxiety in that moment, what did it teach me? Well, it taught me to do the right thing. Like I remember just standing there face to face with this thing, looking at him. And I was just thinking, oh, I know what to do. Because my heart's beating fast, adrenaline's pumping through my body. And I think, oh, you're supposed to actually like not back away. You're supposed to stand there and you're supposed to make yourself real big, right? And I just put my hands up in the air and I went, rah, rah. And the thing looked at me and goes, like, it just looked at me and it was, this guy's a psycho, and ran away, like totally ran away. He was like, don't want to come across one of them again. It was just the weirdest thing. But anxiety sometimes can actually be super instructive to show you the danger that is ahead. That if you didn't have it, you would walk right into a situation, not think anything terrible about it. Did you see that little, there's a video running around the internet right now, and it's this little Southern girl. Have you seen it? She's a little Southern girl, and this bear comes up on her back porch, right? She goes, I want to pet that doggy. And her mom's like, no, no, no. What is that? That's a lack of understanding. Like, you don't pet that doggy. You don't get to do that, right? And the reason for it is because anxiety, her mom's anxiety, helps her realize, like, I have to do something to protect myself. Anxiety is not always bad. Sometimes it's instructive, and sometimes it points you to the danger ahead. So I want to jump into our text here and take a look at verse 6 again. Now, remember what's happening here from last week. King David has been anointed by the prophet Samuel, king over Israel. The problem is they have another king over Israel. His name's Saul, and he's the present-day king. Saul hears about the fact that God has rejected him and has placed David on the throne, even though it hasn't happened yet. And so Saul goes about trying to kill David to thwart the will of God. Whenever you find yourself knowing that you're here and God's will and plan is here, and it happens to all of us, there's no judgment in that. But when you find yourself, here's God's plan, here's our plan, and you find yourself in opposition to his plan, you will always bring suffering into your life. Because God loves you, he's not gonna let you walk down a path of destruction, so he's going to introduce hard things. And so this is what happens to Saul. David leaves, he goes and he spends time with the Philistines, who are great enemies of theirs, but he does this thing, he writes this letter, it's Psalm 37, the thing we're looking at, to all of his men who remain in Israel, and all of his men who remain there as Saul seeks them out to put them to death. And so he writes these encouraging words to them. Verse 6, he will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. He's like, guys, I want you to realize this, but take a look at this because it's really amazing. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. In other words, one day you will have a reward for the good deeds that you're doing right now, for your faithfulness, your obedience, your walk with me. One day you're gonna be rewarded for that. But, watch this, but it's not yet because he will make it. He hasn't made it yet, but he will. Sometimes this is what God does in our life. He's like, I'm gonna bring these good things to you. I'm gonna take you on your next step, but I'm not bringing the circumstances into your life yet. And the reason for that is because he's like, I want you to realize that in the waiting, there are powerful things that happen. And we're gonna talk about that in just a second. But the summary of verse 1 here is, one day everyone will see that you were right. And it's true. Eventually, the reward for walking in the right way is that others will see the righteous reward, that it will shine like the dawn, that your vindication will be like the noonday sun. So I wanna look at two different righteousnesses and two different rewards that come in the Bible. Sometimes when you read the Bible, it sounds like it contradicts itself in this way. And what I will say is that the thing we're about to study, 95% of Christians get this wrong in their head. And that leads to all kinds of anxiety about how sometimes we relate to God when we fail and when we fall down and when we mess up. So what does that look like? Well, let's take a look at it. In the Old Testament, we see a kind of righteousness that's different than the New Testament's kind of righteousness, right? They're not strictly completely different, but they're very different. Second Samuel 22, this is David writing, and listen to his righteousness here. He says in verse 24, I, David, was blameless before God, and I kept myself from guilt. And the Lord has rewarded me, here again, we see reward attached to righteousness. And the Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness. So what David says here is really confident in a way the New Testament doesn't seem to be the same confidence. He's like, I'm David, and I was blameless before him, which means that I'm walking kind of faultless. And guess what? I kept myself from guilt. In other words, I'm guiltless. And we see it. The Lord has rewarded this guiltlessness and this blamelessness on according to his righteousness or my righteousness. So there's a kind of confidence that David seems to have that we generally don't have because we've read the New Testament. But this confidence that he has right here, it comes in other places. He's like, search me, O God. Search me and know my heart. See if there is any unclean thing inside of me. I've never prayed that prayer in my entire life. I know there are unclean things inside me. Like, I know I'm not walking righteously all the time. I know I'm not perfect. But he has this weird and strange confidence. And it seems like if you've read the New Testament that it's an unmerited kind of confidence. Look at what Romans says. This is now the Apostle Paul in the New Testament. He writes and he says these things. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So in other words, there's no one that's not guilty. Everyone has been guilty at one point or another. And we all fall short of the standard that God has put up here. That's the glory of God. Then Romans 3:10 says it like this. As it is written, no one is righteous, not even one person. That's what that means. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God, so the wages of sin that we have to pay is because of our guilt. It's a death penalty, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. So we have two different kinds of righteousness, an Old Testament and a New Testament righteousness, and they're very different. It's interesting that in the New Testament, Jesus, God, raises the standard so much more significantly. In the Old Testament was, don't sleep with someone who's not your spouse. In the New Testament, it's if you look upon a woman lustfully, you've already committed adultery in your heart. So the standard moves from just behavioral to actually motivations. And that becomes impossible. And you might go, well, why did God do that? He did it very, very intentionally. And I'm gonna show you why in just a second. He was trying to raise the standard in the New Testament so high that every single one of us would fail. And you go, why? I mean, wouldn't it have been better for him to lower the standard so we can all just kind of like skate over it? No. He wanted it very clearly. He wanted to communicate one very clear thing to every single person on the planet. And that is the standard is so high that no one can get to heaven by their own good works. That not one person can go, I've done really good things. Look at the church I built. I did these great things. God, am I not going to heaven? No, that's not the standard at all. And here's the reason why. Because he loves us like a father, he comes into the places where we're broken and he says, I want to remind you of who you are. You're my daughter. You're my son. You're the person that I called out of a sinful life into a new life. And that new life begins right here and right now, but it begins now and it goes on forever and ever and ever. And that's what I want to pour into you. I want you to catch this. For the wages of sin is death, but watch this, the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And so the idea behind it is no one gets to heaven by their good works, but here's the better part of this. Because we don't get to heaven by our own good works, it's not us holding on to God, giving him our resume, but it's instead God holding on to us. And so what that means, Christian, if you're not a Christian, this doesn't apply to you. But what that means for you if you're a Christian is that when you fall down and fail, watch this, crazy radical nature of our faith, even when you rebel against God consciously, the Bible says, I will be faithful when you are unfaithful. I will be faithful even when you are unfaithful. And when the Father looks down from heaven and he sees the believer, he doesn't see the good deeds and the bad deeds and the balance of these things. You know what he sees? He sees the blood of Jesus that covers over a life. And because of that, when you fail and you fall down and you rebel and you come back, there is therefore now no condemnation. We get to fall and then turn back around and say, Jesus, I'm back. And you go, well, how many times can a person do that and still be accepted? There is no amount of times. That's why the Bible tells us that his mercies are new every morning. It's not because they just are, it's because we need them to be. And so God comes sweeping into our world. He's like, I want the standard to be so high so no one makes the mistake of thinking that somehow I get into heaven by doing the good, right things, that righteousness of my own gets me to heaven. No, it'll be only the righteousness of God. That's what imputed righteousness is. That's what this is up on the screen. So out of the two kinds of righteousness and benefits, they have different benefits. Imputed righteousness is righteousness that we receive from God. It's a free gift. Everyone say free gift. It's a free gift and is given to us when we trust in Jesus by faith. It is based on Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Look at this. The reward of imputed righteousness is eternal life. God secures your eternal life, not you. So you don't go up and down. God's not in heaven doing this. You did well today, you did bad yesterday. You did well today, you did bad yesterday. He's not counting at 1, 2. You've got to be one better when you get to heaven. That's not how that works because none of us would get there. Instead, he's like, I'm grabbing hold of you. And when you feel like you don't want to hold on to me, I will hold on to you. And you know how we know it's true that sometimes we go through hard things and if it was us holding on to God, we would push him away? You know how we know that? Because we do that with the people who are closest to us. We do that with people in our world. When we feel depressed or anxious or weird, we're just like, I just can't right now. It's literally even in the posture, get back. I don't need you in my space right now. And if we're the ones holding on to God, then we lose relationship with him. But because he gave us an imputed, a transferred righteousness, he's like, no, I hear what you're saying, but I've got a hold of you. And you don't get to go away. And you don't get to lose the benefits. And you don't lose my presence. I will hold on to you when you do not hold on to me. I think if the world knew that this is what the gospel looks like, that it is this beautiful, amazing thing that holds them in safety and security all the days of their life, they would see things differently. But there's another side of this too, and it's the kind of David righteousness from the Old Testament. It's a practical kind of righteousness, and this applies to us as Christians as well. Let's take a look at it. Practical righteousness, here's the definition of it. Practical righteousness is doing what is morally right, This is the practice of trusting God and acting with discipline, building spiritual skills. Everyone say spiritual skills. We're gonna talk about this because not everybody has this automatically. We have to develop this. What this means is that the Christian faith is not just a series of propositions we have to believe. What it is a practice that we get to live out every single day of our life. So acting with discipline, building spiritual skills, and living in alignment with God's standards. What is the reward for this? Practical righteousness is a beautiful life. The reward of practical righteousness is a beautiful life this side of heaven. So if you wanna have a beautiful life this side of heaven, if you wanna have eternal life, first, we get our salvation figured out so that we can have eternal life. Second, this is the difference. Practical righteousness is the difference between the Christians that you see that seem to be really blessed in all kinds of ways, and then the other ones, I mean, some people just are naturally really good at unrighteousness. Like you got friends maybe like that, where they just fall into every trap, every problem. They just seem to always have drama. Why is that? They never learn to be wise. And there's a difference between having knowledge and being wise. Wise is the application of the right kind of knowledge. The reward of practical righteousness is a beautiful life. Now, please hear what I'm saying. That doesn't mean that as a Christian, you won't suffer. I mean, we've got Paul, the apostle in Philippians, and he's basically laboring in jail, right? The Bible says he's shackled hands and feet. And you know what he's doing? At midnight, he's singing hymns and praise songs, and everybody else in the whole thing is just, yeah, let's sing that, Paul. And they're singing together. And you know what God does in that moment? He shakes the earth, and all those chains fall off. The doors fly open. He walks out. You know what he starts doing? Praising God and telling people about Jesus. Why did God open the prison for him? Why did God set him free? He opened the prison and he set him free because Paul was a man who was committed no matter what to walking in the ways of Jesus regardless of his circumstances. Some of us, we've got the faith, but our circumstances have not yet showed up. You have to wait on the Lord and trust in him. This is what comes next. Practical righteousness. So my wife handed me a magazine. It's called Magnolia. All right. Yeah, I thought more women would know that than men. It's Chip and Joanna Gaines, and if you don't know who they are, I don't know where you've been, okay? But basically, she's like, I want you to see this article about Chip's dad. And it's this article where it tells the story, you know, he grew up in a family kind of like mine. His dad just bailed at one point when he was young. He had to take on the responsibilities when he was really young to get his brothers and sisters, I can't remember what they were, but his siblings to school. So he had to grow up really fast. But he became a guy who just worked. He worked and worked. Like, he worked from the mornings, he worked in the evenings, spent time with his family. It's basically all he did. Chip called him like a grinder. He's just a guy who just continually works and makes it all figure out. Doesn't always make it right the first time, but just gets it done over time. And he talked about this, but now he's in this phase where he's got grandchildren and he's just doing the most. I mean, the reason why Chip is a follower of Jesus today, and the reason why they teach their children about Jesus is because of his father. And the grandkids call him Bobo. And he just does these amazing things. He tells the stories of the Bible to them just as they're sitting around. And they're so excited and they're so engaged. And they've got these moments where he's just sitting there with his kids. And he is praying with, or his grandkids, and he's praying with them at night. And he's putting them down and teaching them, like putting them down for bed. And I'm just sitting there reading it. I get to the end of it. My eyes are filled with tears. And I say, I want to be like Bobo. You know, I want to be like Bobo. And I'd even know my wife was around. She goes, Mike, you are like Bobo. And I think sometimes what happens when it comes to our righteousness is that we don't see what all the work that God has done in us when we look at ourselves sometimes. But others do. And the reward of practical righteousness is that God makes that story beautiful to other people, not just to you. God wants to build a beautiful life for you and a beautiful story for you, but it requires us to walk in alignment with God's will. And the more we find ourselves outside of God's will, there is no protection, there is no oversight. You may be going to heaven, but you're gonna continue to make the same dumb things over and over and over again, running around in cul-de-sacs of bad behavior that ultimately lead to your suffering. And it's not the will of God. I'm just telling you right now. And you go, well, why isn't it the will of God? Why can't I just do what I want? Because he loves you. Because his desire for you is to be whole, and we have to figure it out. Verse 6 says it like this: he will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. So I love it. Remember, he's talking to his guys. He's like, guys, you can't. I'm exiled right now. You can't see how things are gonna work out. How many of you have ever been in a situation where you're like, you have the faith, but the circumstances have not showed up yet? Raise your hands. Come on, be brave. Awesome. Yeah, same. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. So what does that mean? Eventually, what you can't see right now will show up, and not only will you see it, but everyone else will see it as well. What does that mean? It's gonna shine like the dawn. The Psalms are poetry. They're designed to teach us and communicate spiritual truths to us. So when it says shine like the dawn, this is the imagery that they would have thought about when they were thinking about it. Paul's like, I want you to see that one day your righteousness, because right now their righteousness looks foolish. Sometimes God asks you to look foolish for a season while you trust him, which is why faith is such a flex. Because you're saying, I will believe even when I don't see until I do see. And then when I do see, it looks like this. But look at the other image. Shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun, your deliverance, your restoration, your healing, your transformation like the noonday sun. What is the noonday sun like? It's just high in the sky. It's receiving most of the light and everyone can see everything. So he's like, one day, guys, you're gonna look back on your life and you're gonna know, and everyone else is gonna know, that when you had faith in God and you trusted in my leadership, David's saying, then God will prevail and so will you. And you need to know that's true, because it's the in-between times sometimes that makes us filled with anxiety. And again, that's why faith is such a boss move, because I believe when I don't see so that one day I will see. So what does vindication look like? Verse 7, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Can I just say I don't like that? I mean, anybody else? Yeah. So verse 7, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways when they carry out their wicked schemes. As David challenges his men to trust him, he's saying, wait on the Lord. But what kind of waiting? What does this look like? Well, Psalm 130, verse 5 is David again, and he says it like this, I wait for the Lord. So what he's talking about is, I have a practiced discipline of waiting for the Lord. This is the thing that I do. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits. So he's not just sitting around like this. When are you gonna show up, God? Or complaining or whining. What he's doing is, he's actually wholeheartedly engaged with his life until God shows up to deliver the circumstances that his faith already has. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in his word, I put my hope. Not in the outcome, not in the circumstances, I put my hope in what God says about me and what God does for me. That's what we do. But waiting is a discipline, guys, and it's really hard. It takes self-control to be patient. So I was reading a book, a lot of books for this series, and one of them is written by a lady named Olivia Reams. She's a doctor. She's a researcher of anxiety and control, right? Anxiety and control at the University of Cambridge in England. And this is what she says. Self-control is like a muscle. The more you use it, the stronger it gets. The more you use it, the stronger it gets. In other words, when we make ourselves do hard things, it resets our tolerance for hard things. What she said, and the implications of her study was this, that people who have high levels of self-control, the ability to do things that they don't want to do, or the ability to delay gratification, these people are the ones who have the lowest levels of anxiety in our society. And the reason for that is because she says that the more anxiety a person has, it's because they're unsure of their competency or their ability to accomplish the task. So anxiety is always future forward. It is like I'm scared, anxious about something that's going to happen where I'm not sure what the outcome is going to be. But here's the thing. If you teach yourself over and over and over again to do really, really hard things, here's what happens. Your brain begins to change. I talked about this in the last series. It's a neuroscience principle, right? And it's called Hebb's Law. And Hebb's Law basically says, as your brain, and I love this, you know why I love neuroscience so much? Neuroscience is the way God wired the brain. God wired the brain so that we can walk with him in consistency. And Hebb's Law teaches us that. Neurons that fire together or near each other, wire together. What that means is this, is that over time, when you do something over and over and over again, it becomes easier to do it. So my friend Mark Winkler is he was my high school buddy. And Mark taught me how to drive stick shift. He brought his car over, a Volkswagen Rabbit, 1988. And he brought it over, 1986, I'm sorry. And brought it over to my house. And he's like, I want to teach you how to drive stick. I'm like, your car has too many pedals on the ground and some weird thing in the middle. And see, when I was in this phase, I was in something called unconscious incompetence. It means I didn't even know there was such a thing as a stick shift car. He's like, I want to teach you to. It's a lot of fun. I was like, okay, how many of you can drive stick shift? Raise your hands. Okay, that's a really good, the first service was like, what's a stick shift? You know, it was amazing, right? And so I had unconscious incompetence. I wasn't even aware of what it was until I was told. And then we got in the car, right? And I did what you guys did probably. Like he said, all right, I want you to take this little stick right here and I want you to put it in gear. It goes like this, right? And so I just jammed it in as hard as I could. It went, gosh, and it goes in. He goes, well, you're gonna kill my car if you do that again. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna learn how to push in the clutch, then slowly let out that clutch while simultaneously pushing down on the gas. And then I did the second thing you did. Right? It was awful. It was weird. It was strange. The third thing, I did what you did. It went poof. He's like, turn it on again, okay? And then, so now we're in this place where it's like, I've got unconscious competence now. I'm like, I'm trying to figure this out. I don't know how to do it yet. But then you move from that unconscious competence to conscious competence. Now I'm aware that I can do it. Like I can do it, but still not really good. You know, that's all I can think about, pedal, gear, shift, okay, the whole thing. And you're doing it. We all went through this exact same process. No one gets into a stick shift car and gets it the first time, no one. Because the brain's not wired like that. But then over time, what happened was because we just kept doing it over and over again. Now I can get into any stick shift car and it doesn't really matter, just like you can. We don't even listen. We're not looking at the RPMs. Okay, shift at 4,000, right? That's not what we do. We just hear it in the background, the engine, and we can make the change. We don't think about it. It's not part of us anymore. What happened? In your brain, you took something super complicated and you broke it down into these steps. You did it over and over and over again. And eventually, your brain wired together in such a way that it takes absolutely no effort for you to do it anymore. The same thing, guys. It's true about obedience and walking with God. The more you walk with the Lord, he's wired the brain in such a way that over time, as you walk with him, it becomes easier and easier and easier to do so. You know, when we first become followers of Jesus, we have to rid ourselves of maybe some moral things that we're doing that we go, I don't want to do that anymore because Jesus has changed my heart. But sometimes it's hard to do that. It's hard to take that next step. The reason for that, again, is because you have patterns in the brain of doing these other things all the days of your life. And to get rid of these things, here's the other side of this equation. When you don't do those things anymore, those neurons actually begin to die away. So it will undo all of these bad patterns and recreate new patterns. This is why there is no such thing as I'm just an anxious person. You are a practiced anxious person. You learned a long time ago that anxiety was a way to solve a problem, and now it no longer works for you anymore. You 100% can change that. All anxiety? No. We've already learned some anxiety, super helpful. We have to be able to do it. But the next big obstacle for us is failure. My mom struggled with this all the days of her life. She was a person who was intensely scared of failure. She would never try anything. Big dreams, big goals. I'll come back to her in just a few minutes. But you may know Sarah Blakely, another person that's most likely known by women, not by men. She's one of the new sharks on Shark Tank. She's a billionaire and she created a thing called Spanx. Don't say anything. We want to keep the mystery. Okay? All right. But this was an amazing product. And she built the company from the ground up by herself, did all this work. You know why she did it? Every week, she would get together with her dad. And her dad would sit down with the kids, and he would ask one question. And the question was, what have you tried this week that you failed at? And if the answer was nothing, he goes mad. And the reason for that was he knew something super clear that led to her being a super high-performing person. And I'm talking about your spiritual life, this is true, and every other life, your work life, every other part of your life, this is true. But he knew this one thing. If you spend time afraid of failure, you will fail. So what you gotta become comfortable with to be a less anxious person is to realize failure is okay. And when you do fail, it's not a character flaw. Watch this, this is so important. Failure is not a character flaw, but if you choose never to fail, it is a character flaw. Because it's self-protection. It's just you saying, I want to stay small. And I watched my mom stay small all the days of her life and die small. And I will tell you guys, she was the most anxious person that I've ever met in my life because she didn't do hard things. She didn't do them over and over and over again. And this thing we're talking about, super simple intellectually to understand, but to put it into practice just requires you and I to get into it and do it, not to think about it, to do it. Because the more you do it, the more you do it, the more you do it, the more that things begin to change. So I want to introduce you to another guy. His name is Epictetus. None of us know him unless you like Greek philosophy. Epictetus was a Stoic philosopher. He was born about roughly 30 years after Jesus' crucifixion. And this is what he says. Oh, by the way, this is Epictetus right here. Epictetus, like all godly men, has a righteous beard. And it was an amazing guy. Yeah. I don't know what it is about Greeks, but they definitely had those curly beards. Greeks, am I right? Okay. So here's what Epictetus said. Some things are in our control and others not. Okay, can we just pause right here and go home? All right, this is super important. Like, if you wanna be a less anxious person, figuring out control in our lives is central. Some things are in our control, others are not. Things in your control, in our control, are our opinions, our pursuits, our desires, our aversions, things we don't like, and in a word, whatever are our own actions. So I control me. Things not in our control are things like our body, you know, maybe sudden cancer or something like that, property, reputation, command, and in one word, whatever are not our own actions. So Epictetus breaks things down into things we can control and things we can't control. And I wanna take that just one step further, and I wanna make it super practical for you. How do we figure out what makes us anxious and not to be as anxious? So I guess we could ask ourselves a question. Let's go ahead and ask that question right now. Is accepting a loss of control or exerting more control over our lives the better strategy for relieving anxiety? Which one's better? Is accepting a loss of control? It's like, I don't have any control, so I'm just gonna like give it up. And this is a very common thing that Christians do. Sometimes they'll go, I'm gonna let the Lord do it. I'm gonna let go and let God. Like there's a verse about that, right? Over our lives. Or is it better strategy for us just to like take control and be like, I can make this happen? Which one is right? Well, the good news for us is that the research is super clear and the answer is yes. Okay, all right. So let's take a look at this. We'll talk about two things. One is minimizing control and one is maximizing control. And let's take a look at minimizing control. There we go. Minimizing control, what is the definition of that? Not controlling things under your control. This again was my mom. She lived a very small life. She would always say, I would love to do this and I would love to do that. But she never took any steps toward it because she feared failure. And because of that, she was not controlling the things that are under your control. So let's go back to David for a second. He writes to the guys and he's saying, here's what the Lord wants me to tell you guys. Stay in place. Don't be angry and overwhelmed. Don't let your anger rise to the level, don't let your fears rise to the level of anger and anxiety that overwhelm your life. Don't do it, don't do it. So what I want you to do is I want you to wait on the Lord. So waiting on the Lord doesn't mean everything else stops in your life. It just means don't do the thing that God asked you not to do right now, but you have all these other things. When the Lord says, wait on me, he doesn't mean don't go to work. He doesn't mean don't feed your cat, right? He does mean don't have a dog though. Just kidding, cat person. Okay, minimize control. Minimize control, not controlling things under your control. Like for example, financial planning is a great example of this. If, remember, the reward of practical righteousness is a good life this side of heaven, right? So financial planning, some people, my mom was like this, financial planning, it's too hard, I don't understand finance, I've never been a good saver. I'm gonna give you a 100% foolproof plan to have more money in your life, 100%, okay? It's called Amway. No, I'm just kidding. Here we go. 100%, it works for every person and has forever, okay? Because this is how simple it is, okay? This is my wisdom for you. Are you ready? Spend less than you make. Yes, 100% of the time that works. It does. And if you do that, you have more stuff. So here, like we're talking about financial planning, you just throw it under this, you lump it under financial planning. You're like, oh, I don't understand about shorts and calls and derivatives. I don't know. You don't need to know any of that. You just need to know someone who knows it, or you could just learn it yourself. I've never been a good saver. You know how to be a good saver? Stop being a bad one. I don't, it's that simple, right? But finances are often quoted as one of the most difficult and stress-inducing things in our society. when it doesn't always have to be, and this is different for every guy. Like I've spent time with guys who have piles and piles of money that are just as broke. They have all kinds of wonderful things in their life, live on wonderful pieces of property on lakes around such, but they have no money whatsoever. I know a guy in my neighborhood who he's done lawns, and his kids now do lawns ever since he was like a young man. And guy is he's just sitting on a mint. It's what you do with it, right? But you have to do something, because if you don't do something like this will be an anxiety for you all the days of your life. Relationships, it's not worth trying anymore. I can never communicate my feelings. I don't have good models. I didn't either. I didn't have good models for that, but I have good relationships. And here's how I started, and this is how you can start too. When I was 18 years old, I became a follower of Jesus, and I went to First Alliance Church over on Lake Underhill Road, okay? Big red steeple building, 500 people, great church at the time. And I was trying to figure out how to just stop doing all the immoral things I was doing. I was trying to figure out how to walk with Jesus. I didn't know. I knew nothing. My parents weren't examples. So what did I do? I just looked around the church. And I saw this guy sitting way over there in the corner. And he had this really pretty wife. I was like, I looked at him, and he was like super engaging. People were around him. He had these great conversations with people. Just really neat guy. And then I looked at him, and he wore a blue button-down polo shirt with the polo. Tan pants, brown leather belt, and loafers. And I was like, that's the guy. That's the guy I need to be like. And so you know what I did? I went to JCPenney, got me some tan pants with a crease right down the middle, right? Got myself a blue button-down without the polo, belt, loafers, showed up at church the next weekend. I started that way. Imitation is the greatest form of flattery. So I just started with the smallest of things. How do you dress better? How do you think better? And I just, over time, you know what? I never spoke to that man ever. Never spoke to him ever. Never had a conversation with him. I've had mentors in my life that I watched from a distance over and over and over again. There are better men than me that do all kinds of things. And I have relationships with some of them, and I learn from them. You don't need models in your life to figure these things out, but stop minimizing control. Watch this. As soon as you realize that you are a control minimizer and you choose not to do it, that becomes a moral thing in your life. God's like, I can fix this. I just need you to cooperate. But the other side is equally hard. Maximizing control does this. Trying to control things out of your control. This is the worst, right? Trying to control things that are like parenting styles. Some parents are just like, I'm gonna micromanage every little bit of my child's life. And you know the reason for it, right? It's like, because I'm a good mom. No, here's the reason for it. Because when we have children, we look at our kids, they're great when they're little and they can't do anything wrong, right? You're just like, oh, you're so wonderful. Post for the picture, you know? And they're just like it's so wonderful. But then they get to 13, 14, 15, 16, and then like they do their own thing. Like, why is your hair that way? Why do you have hair? Like whatever it is, we're frustrated by it, right? You know? We're just like, why do you act that way? Why aren't your grades better? And we're just like, And the reason for it's not really about them, it's about us, because we think that they're a representation of us. So like they're this visible, and this can be really painful. If you got kids that are really, really, like they're just off in some way, and almost every family has something like that. But if a child's a little bit off in some way, you can feel it yourself. Watch this. If we choose to do that, we crush the spirit of that person. And in doing so, we really mess it up. We screw it up for ourselves and for them. These are just other things, like health outcomes, a hyperfixation on the latest diet fitness craze, always measuring yourself against others, looking at everyone else going, why are they bigger? Why are they skinnier? Why are they whatever? That's true. I mean, do you know how you know somebody who goes to CrossFit? They'll freaking tell you. Okay, that's how you know. So I was at CrossFit last week. Okay, but that hyperfix, there's nothing wrong with being fit or being healthy. But when you take it and you say, I'm gonna take my control and I'm gonna measure my worth by what I'm trying to control in my life, that becomes problematic. So, verse 7, be still and wait for the Lord. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil. We have an election coming up, and it's going to get angrier and angrier until that day. But I hope not for you, because wisdom is right here in the book. Refrain, which means hold back your anger and turn away from your rage. Why? because it leads only to evil things coming into your life. James gives us some really wise thought. James 1, 19 and 20. He says, my dear brothers and sisters, talking to Christians, take note of this. In other words, pay attention to this because it's really important. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. We in our society are not listening, always speaking, and very angry. And why would we not do that? Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. I need you to hear that, because you'll hear brothers and sisters in Christ, and we love these people, but you'll hear them say things like, things have to change, I'm just mad about it. Your madness about whatever issue that you're mad about has never changed the issue. Probably hasn't even changed anyone else's heart on the other side. But here's the thing. The Bible says very clearly to you and me that anger does not produce righteousness that God desires. In other words, it's worthless to God. So if it's worthless to God and we want to be the people of God, then we won't want to do the things that would make us worthless to God. And we want to be a beacon in the world around us right now to say, I'm confident that a king is on a throne no matter what president's there. I'm confident that what's going to happen, God is in control of it. I'm confident that I can control my response to that. Verses 9, 10, and 11, Psalm 37. For those, watch this, this is the encouragement towards the end. For those who are evil will one day be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. And in this situation, he means the land of Israel. A little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. Look, remember the beginning of this? We can't see deliverance. We can't see our rescue. And he's like, eventually, guys, not only will you see your rescue, you won't even see the problem people around you anymore. Even when you try to look for them, they will not be around you anymore. Why? Because they will not be found. Because God makes all things right in the end. Amen? Amen. Father, we come before you and recognize that that we sometimes minimize the control in our life when we should take responsibility for things. We don't. But then sometimes we over-control things. And in over-controlling things, it causes more anxiety in us and fear in us, and it causes anxiety and fear in someone else too. So Father, we want to hold the things that you've called us to hold and to let go of things that we are not supposed to hold. Father, we want to be those people who consistently do the hard things so that we can choose one day, God, to have a better sense of response to stress. We don't want to just be overwhelmed by every stressful thing that comes into our life. We want to be confident and competent that we can do hard things because we want to be the people that you've called us to be. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
It's good to be with you today, Grace. My name is Rick. I'm one of the pastors here. If you're serving in the next service, you need to go to your huddle. I'm going to go ahead and dismiss you. I do want to share some good news with you. As of this week, our Center for Teaching and Healing is officially under construction. And so we are, you can celebrate that. We are, it's really a great tangible evidence of your big-hearted generosity and a reminder on an update on our good initiative, which is the two-year discipleship journey we began in December of 2022. And so we have had a long-time dream to launch the largest counseling center in Central Florida to be an opportunity to provide hope and healing for our church. And so the Center for Teaching and Healing is going to become the new home for Grace Counseling. So you could not come soon enough. Last year, we had 7 rooms, and right now we have 7 rooms. We're going to be expanding to 24 rooms in the new space. Last year, we had over 7,600 appointments that we kept. We're already on track this year to be at over 10,000 appointments in those 7 rooms. And so this is going to allow us to more than triple our capacity to care for people. And so I want to encourage you to be a part of that. God is doing so many good things, and he's doing that through your faithfulness here at Grace. If you want to learn more about the Good Initiative or become someone who supports the mission of Grace, you can do that online at discovergrace.com/give. You can always give in the boxes in the back of the room. You know, just as a reminder, the primary goal of the Good Initiative has always been 100% engagement. And so if you are new to Grace, you're new to this journey, we want to invite you to be a part of that. Be a part of what God is doing through this church. God's doing some great and exciting things. And so hope you can come and be a part of that with us. I'm going to ask you if you would to stand at this time as we get ready to dismiss. If you would like someone to pray with you, we do have members from our prayer team available after the service on either side of the sanctuary here at the front. May God the Father, Son, and Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you as you live in his world as his people. Good is ahead, Grace. Go in peace. Amen.